I want to acknowledge and pay respect to the Awabakal people and the Peminlong clan on which this gallery is located, and to acknowledge that this is actually contested land, and it still is contested space, and we respect that in at U of N, and particularly in the School of Architecture and Built Environment. For those of you who don't know me yet, my name is SueAnne Ware. I'm the head of school. It's SueAnne. Most people have been calling me today SueAnne Ware, which is quite weird. It's quite a strange one. So this is our kickoff lecture for Practice Matters this year. And what's fantastic about this particular lecture series is that it's public, so it's open to the public. We tend to get a lot of students, a lot of practitioners, a range of people from all walks of life. But it is about us engaging outside of the academy. It is about us introducing very fantastic practitioners and fantastic architects, landscape architects, etc., to Newcastle and the wider, brighter community. We've got some fantastic sponsors this year, BKA Architects, HDC, so Hunter Development Corporation, obviously the Lockup and their fantastic presence. The food's provided by Nagasu, who is also one of the principal owners, is a graduate of architecture. So if architecture doesn't work out, you can always do a restaurant. Hebel, I think that's it at the moment. We are always looking for sponsors, so please, if you have ideas, come forward. There's something a little bit different about perhaps this Practice Matters than the one we started last year. Last year, it was really just about having a better presence, bringing architecture to the people, and really, you know, kind of putting ourselves out there a bit more than we had perhaps previous other years. This year is really about highlighting women in practice. And I suppose we talked a little bit about it earlier today, sort of what happens when you graduate architecture. You usually go through with about 50% female and 50% male. When you get out, it's about the same. Women make about 2% less. And then as you get older as a female in architecture, your salary gap becomes bigger, so up to 10% when you're about 35 years old. And the number of men who stay with it are there, and the number of women who drop out of the profession starts to dramatically plummet. By the time you're Emma Guthrie's age, which I won't reveal, you're making 15% less, and you're outnumbered 4-1. By the time you're my age, you're outnumbered 22-1. And you're making 2% more. Good news! So there is light at the end of the tunnel, but it is quite a pronounced gender differentiation. And so rather than, you know, highlight that and try to guilt people, what we thought we would do is talk about terrific women in practice this year. And really, it's not about how a female does architecture different or better or whatever, but it's really about saying how great these practices are, but they're seldom acknowledged. And I think that's also because lots of women can be quiet achievers. And my first two speakers of the night, when we were like, give us your bio, can I share it with someone? Can we do it together? It was a really, what I love about working with females in design is that we tend to go, oh yeah, it's not just about me, it's about me and all these other people that I have a relationship with in practice. It's very different sometimes with men, no offense, not all men. And so what's fantastic about our first two speakers is they want to speak together. They're also tutoring in a fantastic trio of three. Andy couldn't make it tonight, but Karen and Shelley are here. And so we're going to give a little bit of a background. So Karen Lambert, for those of you who haven't met her, she graduated from Sydney University. She hadn't discovered Newcastle. It's not her fault. She's actually the chair of the Mort Bay Building Club, which is a pretty interesting thing, and I'm wondering if she's going to tell us anything about that, where it's this kind of student-run, student initiative. It's pretty fantastic, actually. I did a little bit of research on that one. She's been a leader in this instance, a president, vice president for the West Pittwater Community Association, where those of you who know that part of in and around Sydney know the development pressures there. You know how beautiful it is, and you know why we need advocates who are very well versed in design to rethink some of the strange things that various developers and even state government bodies have for that area. She's practiced for over 20 years, so she's making that 2% more. And a lot of private residential, but also a lot of public works. And she's a solo practitioner, so she can talk to you about what it's like to be by yourself, but also how you then have instances where you come together and bounce off others, and what it is to be a solo practitioner. She's probably one of the lead advocates that you'll see in our series for ecologically sustainable design. And that's, it's stuff that maybe in a certain generation, that's just stuff you think, wow, that's A to B, that's what should happen. But I guarantee you, when it first hit here, it was controversial. And the fact that it's so much a part of our practice now, and we expect it, it's an absolute important part of practice. It's actually people like Karen who made it much more mainstream. The back end of her bio, she tells us she's a mother and a carer, which again, not a lot of men have that on their CV, and I love that. That's fantastic. She's worked a lot with Indigenous communities and certainly with aged people, so you'll see a pretty different kind of practice here. Right, so in contrast to that, we've also got Shelley Indyk. She's from Sydney. She went to Sydney Uni as well. I have to tell you, ladies, you know, start changing that advocacy path. It is back when it was good, but now that Newcastle surpassed it. I have a little bit of a thing about Newcastle. But she also went to Hobart, so she understands actually what it's like to be in a regional centre. Hobart and Newcastle have a lot in common, and so it's really interesting that with Sydney. Wow, she's been in Africa. She's actually even taught at Sydney Uni, but then again, she decided Newcastle's better. She created her firm in 1988, back when some of you weren't even a twinkle in the mother and daddy's eyes. And I have to say, she's been creating a very unique identity and practice ever since then. Again, similar to Karen, she's also worked with diverse communities and diverse cultural backgrounds. She's worked a lot in Redfern and some of the housing cooperations work that she might show you tonight during the 80s was pivotal in rethinking how urban Aboriginality and urban Indigenous spaces worked. She's also done work in Palestine, and again, if you know anything about that area of the world, working with disadvantaged communities, working with places that are in, you know, very unpredictable environments becomes a very interesting way of being an architect. I think she's going to talk a little bit about the mosque tonight. A little bit? No? Oh, man. A little bit about a mosque she worked on in Nazareth, which is a very different commission for a female architect. Generally speaking, depending on what sect Muslim, it becomes quite interesting. I've worked with Muslim communities as well, so it's very interesting that I hope you talk a little bit about that. But she's got a huge range of projects as well. So these are two very accomplished practitioners. So with that, I'd like to welcome Shelley and Karen the stage.
Hello everyone, thank you, thanks for coming, and SueAnne, it's a really good initiative. I know recently, was it last year? I mean, time goes so quickly, there was a whole sort of like champions initiative that was sort of announced with some of the big firms in Sydney. Sometimes I wonder when things get announced whether or not the backup and follow-up actually means that those things make a difference. So it'd be nice to see if it does. Okay, so SueAnne's told you I'm a sole practitioner. I'm 54. I call myself a building design consultant. This is a word of warning to especially the young women here. If by the time you've had children, you haven't gone through the whole thing of registration, it's pretty unlikely you will, because it takes a lot of time that, in fact, you actually want to spend on other things. So that's just something to keep in mind. Okay, at a conference in Melbourne a couple of weeks ago, there was a really good a speaker called Neil McLaughlin. He was in London, and he started with the statement that practice starts when you first start university. In his office, 10% of the staff's time is spent on research, and that's not about finding out about new materials or construction methods, but about following a line of inquiry, which I think sounds like a really reasonable way to keep people engaged. I didn't actually ask him, I was sort of dying to, about how does that sit with overtime, but anyway. But he does firmly believe in the value of the theoretical, not just the pragmatic, which is what the term practice implies. Just to follow through on the etymology of matter, it is mater, which is of course origin, source, and mother. So there we go. Good name for a series. I'd suggest practice starts once you move towards noticing and trying to get a better understanding of a particular field of endeavour. And I guess mine started as a young girl when I relocated from Singapore to Australia, and the memories I brought from living in Asia and the new exciting world of Australia and trundling around project home villages with my parents as they looked for a house to build on the corner block of St. Ives subdivision, which was across the road from Ku'ringai Chase. And I mean, it was really lucky that we were across the road from the bush, because that's become something that's incredibly sustaining to me. We saw lots of houses. It was the era of Pettit and Sevett. Do any of you know about Pettit and Sevett? Have you ever heard about Pettit and Sevett and the Sydney School? It was a really interesting time when, in fact, the topography and the landscape was actually began to be appreciated. And part of that was actually a follow-on, because there were actually more educated couples coming through universities who were buying these new subdivisions and were looking for some sort of solution to what their building needs were. In our street, where my parents built their house, nearly a third were Pettit and Sevett. They were split level, open plan, had balconies. Alas, ours wasn't one. We ended up with something called the Colonial. It wasn't really colonial, but there was an Italian tile floor in the living areas. There was a tiled entry porch and French doors that led onto it, and there was a hallway that had the sense of a room about it, and its connection to the stairway in some way were reminiscent of our quite grand house that we left when we left Singapore. And Singapore was a British colony, so this off-the-shelf sort of house with its Tasmanian oak floors, which were included in the price, triggered some collective memory in our family, and I think that that's a really interesting thing. I distinctly remember that we all felt some sort of sense of homecoming. I cringe now thinking about its orientation and the fake upstairs window shutters. But once I was sort of inculcated into the world of architecture at uni, I began to open my mind to the larger cultural proposition of architecture. Space became charged with layers of meaning beyond it's lovely, it's nice, grand, or has a good view. My first slides show a very pragmatic response to my student status. I moved out of home by the time I was at the end of my first year, and whilst I worked in restaurants to earn the rent, my interest in creative practice and the making of things, objects, drawing, and the world of food became part of my way of being in the world. And I think that I would call them part of the way I see my life and practice. So what I did was I actually made jewellery, and it was actually an exploration in componentry and materials and colour and form. That's a brooch, that's actually two earrings, a brooch, and the body is actually a bracelet. That was my woman that I made for an exhibition. And I had a lot of fun in doing it, and it kept the money coming in, and it was doing something that, in a sense, I was in control of. So that was great. In my break between degrees, I restored a house and a stables in Strawberry Hills, which is sort of between Redfern and Surrey Hills. It's quite close to Sydney Uni, and some of my Bachelor of Science cronies came along with me and they became builders. And it was a great experience to actually be in there in the real world, so I was very lucky. I returned to finish the second degree with some practical building experience and probably way too much confidence. Neil Durbach and Harry Levine, who were sort of new to Sydney and were making a big splash because they won the Tusculum Design, they were my fifth year tutors, and we didn't quite get on. They came to see the house and I guess we just agreed that we didn't really agree. And that was okay. At this time, a group of us who had all sort of dreaded the second degree started a collective studio of architecture and art students, and SueAnne mentioned that. It was a fantastic harbourfront warehouse in Moreton Bay. And for us, it was a necessary reaction to the uni, which didn't provide studio spaces with access. And we were all passionate about architecture and creative pursuits, and we had an educational intent beyond just sharing workplace. The first talk, we started a series of talks there, and our first talk had a fellow called Harry Williamson, who was a fantastic graphic designer and copywriter, and he worked with us and we talked about the importance of, I suppose, it would now be called brand, but it was about logos and how do you actually convey information about what it is you're wanting to do. So we had this, we had a really wonderful evening, and it resulted in us calling our studio the Moreton Bay Building Club. So we had a very strong sort of vision that we were a group of students supporting each other, but also that there were matters that needed to be discussed beyond uni. And that was something that we did with having weekly talks during term time, occasionally fantastic rent parties, and a lot of people came through that place and really enjoyed it, and it gave everyone certainly a sense of camaraderie. I think at Newcastle you're lucky with your studio spaces, but that wasn't something that was a given for us, and we knew that it was really important that we were able to support each other. So even that way of thinking is actually a really important aspect of how you actually approach what you do. I did the second degree in 3 years because I had a three-year break in the middle where I, you know, did a house, I worked in a cooperative restaurant and did a few things. And when I went back, not only did we have the studio as a going concern, but a group of us who actually really liked a particular teacher called Peter Myers, we actually ended up paying for him amongst ourselves. I know he gave us a discount, but we actually had a term's worth of him actually talking to us about issues of architecture. And so I suppose that sort of gives an understanding that we were wanting to make sure that our education offered us what we really felt it needed to offer us. A strong strand of my practice has been in design teaching. I also, when I was at uni, began work on my first house, and when I graduated, the building of it was about to begin, and that was, I think, 1989. My first job, official job, was in the Department of Public Works, and I'd rush off on a Friday afternoon and hop on a Southern Highlands train and spent most weekends building the house with my friend and client, and she'd get various tradespeople organised through word of mouth. So this was in, I look at this now and I think no wonder the council took so long to pass it, but the building inspector sort of having to turn it around to see the elevations, whereas I was just thinking, oh, you come in from the north, we'll show it that, we'll show the elevations so you can see where it is. It was a lovely story. My client, she went into council and said, haven't you passed it yet? And he said, no, I just don't know what to do. And she said, well, why don't you just pass it? He said, but what about this and what about that? And she said, well, look, if we write future on that, and future on that, then do you have any problems? Anyway, he didn't, but I think councils, have got a lot more rigorous. Where this was, would be classified as a flame zone these days, for any of you that have had any dealings with architecture. And in fact, this was actually all about a retention pond and reservoir for water. So, you know, maybe it wouldn't, it would still get through. But the idea of it was, and she gave me the most fantastic brief, which was all these words written in different colours, but the idea of it was, I suppose, to respond to the old landscape. There was a sense of a ruin or a spine, which ran through it. I know you're not going to be able to read this easily. There was a shed that gave it protection, but also meant that we could keep building in all weather, and this was the Southern Highlands. And then there were rooms within. So this gives you a sense of entry. There's the shed roof, walls, and there was sort of like this sense of ruin, and it was quite sort of it was quite fey in a way. But what was fantastic is that Lizzie knew a journalist who was wanting to do an article, and so she got some colour designers and we got the house painted internally for free. So these photos are from the article. I had to actually work very hard to convince Babette to get a picture of the exterior. I mean, it nearly got blocked by the basket of gourds, but it was Belle. That was just inside that sense of the, you know, it was very much a house of brick, and you can see the top ruins, the top rooms were built, or the top spaces were basically the ceilings of the rooms below. And inside, just some internal bracing against that large front wall, even though the house had independent, or the roof had independent columns outside. And barrel bricks. We really worked on a brick patterning to use the local brickwork. I worked, as I said, at Public Works, and I worked there for 12 years and saw a great range and scale. And I saw the department as a great opportunity to learn and contribute. I was really proud to be a public servant. The social benefit and the broad understanding of government are attributes of democracy that I firmly believe in. On the day, my first day on my induction, whilst the state superannuation scheme was being explained, I was sort of numb because I'd found out that my home section was corrective services. And it's very appropriate here tonight because it was commonly known as prisons. It was a shock. I was 27. I desperately read Foucault's Discipline and Punish about the birth of prison to try and make sense of it all. I've worked on a number of prison projects. I've visited many, and whilst incarceration has many issues, corporeal violence as opposed to a person's spirit is thankfully over. This was a time actually also when weekend detention was just starting to be explored, and it was also a time when the police had rebadged themselves as a police service. It's back to police force now, and changing times, and I think that the nomenclature is actually quite telling and important. I still believe that the programs inmates have access to is more important than their cells. I was asked to do, I suppose the first sort of building that I had more involvement with there was a visitor centre, and it was for minimum security, which was a relief to me. I'm just going to show you, whoops, here. This is a lovely, it's like a child's wishing wheel or something. Kids have written their wishes on it. And you know, most of the wishes, if you read them, are all about how they love their families. and they want their families to be safe. This is a slide that shows where Shine for Kids centres are in New South Wales. And Shine for Kids centres has been going for about 30 years, and that's basically set up to ensure that, or to help ensure that children of prisoners actually get opportunity. That's a map with all the various detention centres in New South Wales, and that's the map of Goulburn Prison. I worked in the public works a long time ago, but I thought it was important to talk to you about the range of things I did. It probably would have been illegal for me to keep copies of this building anyway, but suffice to say, can we see something here, this work? Is it on the side? Okay, I'm going to just point. This is the minimum security. All down this hill here, there's something called razor wire. Anyone know what razor wire is? Okay, like you've seen it, it's really nasty stuff. A 4 metre high razor wire fence goes around. Now, the site I was given was sort of actually down here, where it's actually a bit marshy and wet. And I will always be very thankful that, for one of the architects in my area. Her name was Devika de Fonseca. And, you know, I came back and I said, it's a terrible site. It just doesn't feel right. It feels awful. And she said, well, you have to do what you think's right. So I pushed with her support for doing something here. And even though you can't see it, there's actually a triangular-shaped building which the corrective services people were really, really confused by and confronted. But it did get built. And what's really lovely is that I did go past there a bit after it'd been built, and the terraces down the hill, if you see those white dots, they're all umbrellas. So they have the centre, they look down the hill. But the really important thing about it for me was that was the given site. There's the razor wire. Up here, not only did it have a better aspect to the sun, but from being in that space, you could look over the fence. So I thought that was a really, really important thing. Following that, I moved to the Urban Design Unit, which was a pretty exciting time because it was 1993 and the Olympics had been announced, and there were two really good urban designers, Margaret Petrikowski and Darlene Vanderbruggen, who have worked in government and in urban design, and we were asked to do potential projects to do with the Olympics. And it's really funny because you look back now and you see some of the projects that were basically sketched up as ideas are actually, here we go, you know, nearly 20 years on, actually getting an airing, so to speak. Okay, these are other important things that happened. I don't have any baby photos, it's really terrible, but I don't. But so 1992, the first one, 94, and then 2000. I can't believe it, but I returned to work when my first child was only 16 weeks old. But that sort of was the pressure that I put myself under, because I felt that that's what I needed to do to, in order to not to lose ground and to be able to keep working. I moved to the client services division in public works because it had been restructured, and I sort of felt that being more strategic might actually make more of a difference than being in the government architect's office. I might also say that the heritage branch was run by Anne Ware, who was the only female manager. I worked then for just a fantastic client in the sport department of sport and recreation, and again they had a great director, and she was working within the department for cultural change. And there were 12 centres, and they were like little mini fiefdoms. If one centre got a swimming pool, then every centre had to have a swimming pool. Anyway, I worked with Leonie, and it was challenging about trying to bring about a change within a larger organisation, but it was somehow doing it with Capital Works. It was curious. I remember bringing some hydraulic engineers to do a water audit on one of the centres, and their conclusions showed that improved fittings and services would halve the need for the proposed in-ground water tanks. The centre manager was not happy, but that was all part of what was alluded to before about ESD. ESD was a really new term at that time, environmentally sustainable design, and together with that director who was in charge of their Capital Works program, we tried to embed it in all the projects. The current New South Wales government's trying to flog off all the sport and rec centres, and I think that's a great pity. During this time, I was also active in bringing the spokeswoman's program into the department. And you see, some of this sort of feels like history, you know, like way, way ago. But, you know, it was only 93. It's not that long ago. Some of you were probably born then. I hope some of you were. But that program, again, this is a little bit of old history. You know, government goes through times of looking at itself, restructuring, whatever. There'd been a report called the Walensky Report in 78 that had investigated the role and the workings of government, including EEO. And EEO means equal employment opportunity. You might think that that's an unusual thing for me to even talk about, but it was real. It was actually very real. Anyway, the spokeswoman's program was, it was really important because it actually gave women within various government agencies, in a sense, a mandate to be able to speak on behalf of the women who worked in their departments. That might be to do with parental leave, with maternity leave, with all sorts of things. So it was actually a really important program. That started up in about 1978. It got to the Department of Public Works in 94. So there we go. So my practice has very much been about being an agent for change within the situations that I find myself, and I don't know if that's because I'm a social justice tragic or what, but it's just something that drives me and that I respond to. I also sought secondment in other government agencies, because there was a great opportunity that you could actually learn skills and an understanding of the workings of government. I worked in the South Sydney Development Corporation, which was set up under the auspices of the Department of Planning for the whole redevelopment of the South Sydney area, which was the former industrial, the industrial sort of part of the city. My role was specifically as a project manager for the Alexandria Canal, and if any of you know Sydney at all, it's sort of this, it's a rather wide culverted canal. It is tidal, so you could say it's estuarine, and it runs behind Sydney Airport. So the former waste of the tanneries and lots of industrial areas went into this canal. Botany Council had put in planning controls to leave a 10-metre edge as a future green space down both sides. There were lots of heavy metals in the depths, and surprisingly, mangroves were beginning to re-establish themselves. A vision was needed for it, and that was sort of my job, was to try and get that to happen. So as an agent working within government, it might not be you who has the ability to do the plan, but what you have the ability is to affect the plan to be done. The Moort Bay Building Club had actually given a talk at the Institute of Architects, and what we decided to do was to raise for discussion the issue of architectural competitions, because we'd had some people talk at the studio about how in Barcelona young architects were being given really great little small pocket-sized urban spaces to design in a competition manner, and we thought that it was a really good idea to talk about competitions. So what we did is we decided we'd do a competition, and we followed a process that aimed to respect practitioners. So the first stage, which was an EOI, we asked, I think, for an A4 page with no images to actually get them to talk about what, how they might approach it and what their vision would be. The second stage, I think, had about two panels involved. Everyone got paid a paltry sum, but $5,000 in 89 was probably not too bad. So maybe we weren't that mean about it, but it's still an issue. You find a lot of architectural offices where, you know, they're involved in competitions. They might get paid some sort of nominal sum, but they put thousands and thousands of dollars into it. So after South Sydney Development Corporation, I returned to Public Works and I worked in a corporate change team. There was a new Director General and there was a general uplifting of spirits at the time. Ultimately, I think there was goodwill and will to change. But I became a bit disillusioned when the program seemed to get subverted into a clunky and barely intuitive computer system. By then I had the opportunity to go on secondment again. Okay, and this was actually the last part of my time there, and a number of you, of course, John, you'll know this. I was really lucky. I'm sure a lot of you know the 9 healthy living practices that Health Habitat established. Paul Phileros, who died a year ago, he was a leading figure of 3 who started Health Habitat. And it was all aimed at improving environmental health in Aboriginal communities. So simple things like washing your children because they're infectious diseases, you know, keeping vermin away, you know, keeping dust away, etc., reducing trauma. And it was fantastic that my last year, when I worked for the government, I was working with the Department of Aboriginal Affairs, and I remember ringing up Paul, and we were really excited and hoped we'd be able to do a lot. But we weren't really. We were able to just do basic things, and that's actually one of the sadnesses, that there's a lot of money that's spent, but the efficaciousness of what happens is questionable. In 2002, the exigencies of families required my partner and our family to be in the same place. We'd had sort of 19 years of living between the city and on the fringe of it, and so I built my studio and started private practice. And this is my studio. And I was really happy that the only things I had to buy were some new roofing materials, the structure floor, a couple of joists, and the tallow wood for its small balcony. Anyway, it was a room that was all about opening up and being in connection. And this is a wall that you'll see here. That's at close, that's at open. So the whole little space opens up and that's the back of the door. So once I had that, I, you know, was ready to jump in and start doing things. That's a really lovely model made by a woman called Eva Heldegard Brooks. And I put it in here because apart from the fact it really shows you with the gaps, I mean, having the vertical contours, which is such a wild thing to do, it was lovely. But that model was built to explain the way how this site, which was this building here, not this, not that, but this space in here, how the site was actually on this saddle of the hill. And so to the east where there was a neighbour, fairly simple, but you'll see the water tank. This was where there was a lovely jacaranda tree. It was making a garden. So it had, you know, ends that looked to the either side of the bay, and it had this water tank in the middle for gravity feed during fire. Another place I did is, this is also in Pittwater. This house here, the grey building up the top, you'll see it's got a skirt, but if you imagine the skirt wasn't there, that building was down on the ground and we lifted it up and then we built stonework around it. The client was very brave and didn't want any council approval, so we just did it. But it was lovely because it was, this is, you know, here those two gum trees, that was how you approached it. This was leading out. And that was inside. And having that stone base just gave the building a beautiful sense of belonging. And then we had four quite magnificent timber columns and just a cross of structure that then held the little timber frame building above. I've done that a few times where you lift the building up, because one of the things, especially when people have a low budget, and it's also the issue about materials, you lift a building up, you've actually still got a roof, you've still got lots of things, you can rework things, but you've actually got this space underneath, which is suddenly yours to actually work in some way. And it's actually not that expensive to lift something up, as provided it's lightweight. Many of you will not quite be at the stage that I've been at, and that's why I did put it down as part of my bio of being a carer, because basically for all these years I've been a carer. And my father died in late 2008, and it became evident that my mother was in trouble without him. And apart from the grief of losing a partner of over 54 years, she was diagnosed with cancer. The chemotherapy to treat the cancer caused renal failure. And now we're in this incredibly unenviable position that I dreaded being in, where we're now dialysing a frail and demented person because no one can call it. And there are lots of issues for an ageing population and an ageing society. Your parents are probably looking after their parents at the moment, maybe, or you are helping, but there's going to be a time where that's going to be happening to you. And I think as a society, we've really actually got to address and discuss these things, because I find it incredibly distressing. I almost can't take my mother to dialysis, because even though I love her, I want her dead. And even though I love her, I say, what is the health dollar doing dialysing someone who has actually lived beyond her competency? So they're very serious issues that, like, all of us have to deal with. And it's not just about, you know, perhaps being in practice and, you know, doing a great little home for, you know, aged people who, you know, have a little bus stop to sit at and things like that. It goes much deeper into the fact that pharmaceutical companies love the aged, because they are a very good recurrent recurrent client. And old age homes basically have been set up in part because some of our societal structures have broken down. But one of the issues is when people used to live at home, you know, they would actually sort of probably end their lives or die at a time which was sort of natural. But now there's all this intervention. What you find is that, you know, the aged care facilities and the care that they're given basically means that what used to be an inheritance for the next generation actually goes in keeping people alive with sometimes questionable quality of life. So that's a serious thing. Okay. This is a job I'm doing at the moment. It's at Malabar. It's a very, very standard and boring little house, and I don't have many great plans apart from the fact that that big tree is there, and it was all about making the top of the house like a big gallery space, putting a clerestory up so that you got northern light in. And I just wanted to show you this. Like, I've been through models and models and models to try and work with the roof, because there are some times when you just have to be physical. A computer won't do it. So that was an important thing that I just wanted to make sure that you never lose an understanding of how important models are to really work with form. Okay, well, I hope I've sort of talked a little bit about practice. It's sort of been a bit varied, but it's sort of, I mean, I sort of go a bit broader. I sort of think it's the practice of life in a way, because I think once you become immersed in a professional direction, other bits feed into it, but it becomes it becomes something that you just keep doing the do of it, you know? So this is where I am. My mother's still living. My eldest son is wanting to save the world with science. My middle son is wanting to help people through medicine. My youngest son is, he was really, we thought, our potential architect, because he used to design, he used to draw these amazing traps to catch the bush turkey and things like that. And we thought, oh, he's got a sense of process, but he doesn't think architecture makes enough difference. I disagree with him. He is going to go into environmental science if he can't become a wallaby. I'm continuing to tutor. I suppose I'm entering my 20th year of involvement with local politics in the community, and SueAnne mentioned that before. It's an interesting thing. Our community is in change, and I'm just going to just tell you a quick story about it. Scotland Island, which isn't where we live, but it's part of our offshore community. Over the last 15 years, there's been a really marked shift on the island, and there are two things that I'm going to use to, I suppose, qualify what I think is a linked outcome. People moving to the island, I think they've moved there because they thought, wow, this is on the edge of the city, but we can still work in the city, we can commute, and it's really beautiful here. Then what happens, they get to the island and it's a little bit of a walk and whatever, so they get either a car or a golf buggy or a moke or a motorbike or something, so then they'll get off the ferry, or more and more they'll have their own boat that they park at the wharf, so they'll get off, they'll hop onto their thing and they'll get home. And I think that what's interesting about that is that what they've done is they've brought an urban sense of time and constraint to basically a place that used to be much more about the environment. And how I think that is reflected is that there's actually a childcare centre on the island which was built by the community. And when our kids went there, there were probably somewhere between 22 to 30 enrolments there. There are now 7. And it's likely that it won't continue. And so what's happening, that sense of time and the different way of thinking about things that's been brought by these people who have wanted the specialness of the place, has actually not understood that a couple of things. One is that if you move at a pedestrian space through the environment, you notice it a lot more. And it's also just the process of walking actually does something to your physiology and your sense of time and space, and you talk to people. I also think that people are busy, so they'll take their kids and drop them off at childcare on the way. So that begins to pick apart some of those really important sort of like touchstones of community, where kids, you know, they might actually know each other from kindy through to the HSC. And those sorts of things are really important. I don't quite know how we deal with that, but it's, you know, it's an issue. We on the Western Foreshores are really constantly having to advocate no cars and things like that. So one has to remain vigilant. Another thing I do is that I'm an independent on an animal care and ethics committee. I started off with the National Parks and Wildlife just because I was interested in it. I'm now on the Australian Museum one. And that's just, again, it sort of fits a way of giving back. I don't have the skills to understand the biology, but I've got the skills to understand ethical issues. I'm really focusing on reworking homes for people, and part of that is that I just think it's really important, especially with the strength of communities, that they're not diminished. And part of that is that people are able to actually age in place. And what that might mean for a home is very different. And it might not mean older people, it might just mean people whose, you know, kids are putting pressure on the family home. Rather than a $200,000 extension, maybe they pop a caravan down the backyard. I mean, that's the sort of type of intervention I think is really worthwhile to discuss, because it doesn't use a lot of materials and it actually means that people can stay in place. So as you saw from all those years I put up there, I am transitioning back into active practice more, just because my mother is actually now in an aged care facility. And part of that was also, for me as a carer, I had to let go and know that I'd done my best and that I couldn't I couldn't feel guilty about not doing more, because there comes a time where you just have to realize that you have to look forward for yourself. And I'm in the 33rd year of a mutually supportive and loving relationship with my partner. So those are all things that I think go up towards my practice. Thank you.
Well, my talk will be quite different, and it is just really focused on my architectural practice, which sort of is my life. So I'm an architect, and I'm a mother of a 23-year-old son. My partner is a full-time artist, and I run a practice with these wonderful people who have sort of been working with me for quite a while. Louise is actually from Newcastle Uni, and Sylvia, sort of the young bloods. The others have been with me and a few others for probably about 7 years. So we know each other and we work well together. And the practice is really about a studio practice. I think I'll just move into sort of the work. We have quite a diverse practice, and I think that's because that's what I enjoy. So we work on, I started my profession, I won't go back through my education because it's a long, long time ago, but it was fabulous, and I did move around a lot, and in those days of education, and I'm not sure today if it's similar, you could create, in a sense, your own process, and you could go to different universities if you coordinated it. So I did spend time at RMIT in Melbourne and in Hobart. I travelled, which I think you all do at various times, came back. I worked while I travelled and explored, came back and then did my final years at Sydney Uni. So it was a diverse time. It was an extraordinary time. And it probably laid the basis for the sort of work that inspired me and, what I do today. So I have worked on residential work. My early practice was as a sole practitioner. I was doing a lot of renovations. I'm based in Paddington. I've been there for about 25 years. So my early works were around that area, also travelling around a bit in Wollongong and areas like that. So I'll just move, I think, to some images. But basically, from houses, I started to work with communities. So yes, I worked in Redfern for about 8 years or more with Jan Felton, who was a colleague. We worked with Cole James. I don't know if you know much about Redfern from sort of here. It was in the 80s, late 70s and 80s. We actually did do a group of houses, which were the first buildings that I had built that actually eventually got demolished. In my own time, they were strong, they were sturdy. It was really a challenge. We worked on a negative brief, a brief that was about what people didn't want, not what they wanted, which was a really interesting experience. We wanted to bring beauty into the places. There was a strong sense of community in the beginning. Redfern is a tough place. The Aboriginal Housing Company was a cooperative, very sort of interesting, but it was beset with problems with drugs and all sorts of people who didn't respect each other necessarily. Just because they were Aboriginal didn't mean that they were going to get on, that they were of the right tribal connections. Nevertheless, we worked there for a long time as consultants, trying to do various projects with TAFE, educating some of the sort of local kids, with Christian groups, with all sorts of groups, and a lot of the work failed, i.e. it didn't get up off the ground. And this is a big dilemma, I think, with community work, and it's something I've experienced again and again. I don't think it's a failure. I just think, like anything in life, when you're actually able to create something and build it and it is of great value to everyone, it is a unique and fabulous experience, but it does not happen all the time. And community work is difficult because it's not a one-on-one situation necessarily. I have continued to work with communities throughout my practice. So community work also brought me into sort of religious building work. And then I have had quite a history of working in bars, working actually not in bars but on bars. that doesn't sound right either. But through a colleague, through a friend from my youth, who was a lawyer who ended up becoming a publican and buying many sorts of hotels, I started to change hotels. So I'll go through that with you, but they were pubs. And from there, I got work with cinemas, making big, large, new cinemas and rebranding a very Australian-based cinema company called Greater Union. And then from there, I've been working on QT Hotels, which has been another sort of side of work. So the work sort of keeps changing and sort of expanding and contracting, and I work on houses. So, yeah, it's busy, it's interesting. So this is sort of some of the community work that I've worked with. I'm on the board of the Aboriginal Benefits Foundation, which is a not-for-profit organisation that supports any initiatives that we can support to do with art and health in remote communities. And this was one job that I just did in the office for this particular community in Newcastle, which is way up in Gove, very remote, very far away. Very interesting community. And it had come about from the Aboriginal Benefits Foundation core members link with this community. And it was a very stressful time when youth were suiciding at a rapid rate up in Yirrkala. And there were still very strong traditional healers in the community, and there was a very strong desire to create a traditional healing centre that would involve alternative medicines and traditional healing practices. So we just explored the best we could recycling dongas, which are the sort of mining cabins that Rio Tinto and that use up there. So Rio Tinto is in that area. I haven't brought a lot of images of the area, but the banyan tree was the most important thing about the site. The site had been used as a dumping ground for years, but the banyan tree was really symbolic to them and very, very key, as was the freshwater river, and the Yirrkala is by the sea. So this was a job that I just did in the office with Catherine in my office. And it started to have legs, so much so it had to be staged, it had to be modular so that we could either ship it from Darwin, it had to be cyclone proof, and it had to be, you know, cost effective, obviously. So it was, and this was the sort of traditional, so it was basically dongas, recycled, reused, opened up, addition of sort of verandas, big roofs, cyclone proof, had to be tied down, and had to be staged. And the most important one was this one, which was for the young men, because it was the young men who were suiciding at that time. And it's still a big issue. As part of the Aboriginal Benefits Foundation, we created a big art auction at the MCA, and we raised about $400,000 to put towards this, which was going to probably cost about $1 million because it was so remote. And we actually sort of got pricing. Builders sort of were interested to sort of develop it. These were just simple drawings that came out of ARCHICAD, that came out of our modelling, to discuss it with the community. The community actually wanted it to go ahead, but it never did. And to this day, unfortunately, the wonderful couple of the wonderful healers have passed on. There was great disruption in the community, which you may have heard about 5 years ago, with Rio Tinto and all the mining royalties. And we actually had the money
for this project, and it didn't go ahead. The two dongas were actually bought for 30 grand. So this happens in community projects, and I'm still involved. I'm a director on that Aboriginal Benefits Foundation. One can't give up, one just keeps going, and we keep having options, and we support smaller enterprises until we find another significant project that we think, you know, will really happen, and wonderful people support us. So artists give their work for nothing, you know, to support it. It's an important one. This is another community-based project that I was working on for about 8 years. It's actually a synagogue, an education centre, a ritual bath, and a childcare. So it was a very long project. It was community-based. It was also with the larger community to show them what was happening on a site where there was already a major synagogue. It's in Wallara, so it's quite urban. It was very challenging, very interesting, because we had to deal with all of the issues of community, of ritual, of spiritual building, of childcare. And the childcare was on top of the synagogue, which was slightly sunken, and the existing sort of heritage building that wasn't particularly beautiful but was really significant to the community, and the fact that it was built in the 40s during the war for the progressive Jewish community. So the progressive Jewish community is quite different to the Orthodox and came out of Germany, ironically, and allows, you know, women to be rabbis, allows sort of gay marriage to happen, allows all sorts. It's a much more open and very interesting community. So we got the master plan approved. We went through the DA process. The buildings were approved. It was all drawn, went to tender, got a builder, started the first initial work. These are actually old process drawings. I couldn't find the later ones. And the building was quite unusual. It was a free-spanning 35-metre concrete ring beams. Was round because that's what the rabbi really sought, because he wanted the sense of community, whereas the hall building here was a much more sort of, like a hall, quite sort of anti-sort of spiritual in some ways, but a presence. That was cut short. It's not all going to be doom and gloom. But a new president, a new board, lost faith in the project, feared, you know, whatever it was, risk, I think you would call it, and the whole project stopped. I believe it has restarted in a much sort of smaller way. They'd actually even raised the funds for that project. This is a little, very little project that I did decades ago. It actually exists. So it's a community-based project as well, and it was a peace park. And it was an expressions of interest, as was the synagogue. So we won it on an expressions of interest. And this is a single school. It's very a single classroom school that was established very early on, maybe 15 or so, and was used to recruit soldiers during the war. Perhaps it was a bit later than that. And so it's in Oxford Falls, and it was the year of the Peace Park. I haven't sort of got the dates anymore in my brain, but there were peace parks popping up all over Sydney, and this had a relationship with a sister city in Japan. And I've worked with Anne Grimes, who was architectural colleague, Jan Felton, and Alfred Bernhardt, landscape architect, who's now sort of chief sort of landscaper of the Willoughby Council. So it was basically a place of memory and a place to remember. And it was a big stone wall that we created, which is sort of this wall here that held facilities, like held the toilet. There's a pit toilet. And it was basically a walk that was to be taken all the way through, and there were different places along the way for sort of stopping and looking at nature, but also a sort of memorial pool. And then in the actual stone wall, there were different tablets that we selected that had engravings and memory markers. So it's something that's interesting. I've also taught quite a bit over the years at various places, which SueAnne mentioned. I haven't taught probably for about 12 years because my practice has been very busy for myself and I haven't been able to sort of put the time into it. This was a really interesting initiative that actually Anna Rubo from Sydney University with the UN created, which was Global Studio. And it sort of worked for about 5, maybe 8 years. Maybe there's still some offshoots of it happening. It started in Istanbul, and so it was this international community of students who met in Istanbul. We focused on a suburb in Sultanahmet in the old Istanbul called Zarek. And we worked with this sort of community. It was difficult. You know, you worked with the community. Nobody knew anybody. And within, we had a lot of Turkish people, of course, assisting. But one had to be realistic about really, you know, what you were doing, and it was sort of more about relationship building and creating sort of opportunities with people who wanted to. There's always a problem with something like that when you come in and then you leave and people feel a little abused or used. So there were connections that were made with the university. It was a university-based sort of studio. And so the university kept up certain commitments and relationships. And there were small things that came out of that. So, you know, there were small things about working with the women and working on ideas of how they could sort of earn money. And it wasn't all architectural solutions, but it was such an extraordinary experience for all the students to be also meeting each other. And also the sort of children and the community did really connect. So that was great. And I've also worked in Israel with Palestinians and Israelis, which was really challenging in about 1995, where I worked in studios and then I worked in Haifa in the Technion on very political issues in Israel because Israel's very political. And it was a good time in 95 where people were actually making links with each other, unlike today. There were no walls between, you know, West and East Bank and cities. And there's a part of me that just really wants to connect on that level of community and will continue to. It's not necessarily in Pittwater, it's a sort of community that's it just depends, I think. You know, it's the Aboriginal community because of my background in Redfern that kept going. In Israel because I'm Jewish and, you know, my partner's Israeli and we have a connection there and therefore with the Progressive Synagogue. So it's links. I think it's links in your life. This is just some of my residential work. So, and my, when I say my, you know, it's always a team effort and it's never me alone, ever. It may have been once many, 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 many years ago as a student. So, you know, you work with the client, you work with your team in the office, and of course you work with, you have to work with a fantastic builder and builders and craftspeople. So when I work in houses, and I don't do an awful lot of houses these days, I sort of tend to like to sort of restrict the palette a lot because my commercial work is really quite varied. It's got a lot of texture and colour and graphics and boldness. So these are beautiful opportunities to just restrain myself. And also work with place and context and site and things that in the commercial world, they're very internal spaces. So this is a house down the south coast for a wonderful client who I'd actually done some work for in Ostermere. And I don't know, they look very blurry from here, but hopefully they look better from there. And it's a coastal house, and the only steel in the house was basically in the reinforcing, which was galvanised. So it's concrete and it's recycled timber and timber cladding. So it's concrete internal walls, insulation, stud work, timber cladding, Caulfield blocks on the outside, but timber cladding all towards the north. So it has a very sort of strong, that's the north face. It steps down through, I'll show you later because I've got other aspects that will show you how sort of the house works. Otherwise we'll be here forever if you want to be. This was a house also that I did in Paddington quite a few years ago, which had a very strong sense of borrowing the landscape of Trumpet Park. So I don't know if you know Paddington well, but this is a street where the land drops away, valley, and then there's the park opposite. And it's in the true Japanese tradition, you know, that park was sort of almost in the house. So we used big renovated doors that sort of lifted up, and what was a very tiny terrace, 4 meters wide, once you take the stair out, 3 meters, tiny spaces, suddenly sort of breathed in a different way. So this was the bathroom on the upper level, which sort of seems to be a recurring theme because it'll come in some of the hotel work, this sort of glowing lantern box. So it, because it was a very narrow, and you know, we know all these solutions. I'm not showing you anything that's sort of extraordinarily different, but it's the working of the space. So of course we worked the stair, so the part of the kitchen was under the stair. The timber boxes worked so that the plumbing and all our services could go up into the bathroom above and down. And we used stucco finishes to explore that sort of shinier surface. That's this little space here that became a desk space for the client. And then that's the kitchen and this section here. And you can see the timber panel boxes in that section. This pond here was actually the water retention. It actually was used for the water drainage of the roof. And downstairs is the back access lane. I've worked on a lot of residential projects in the past that sort of didn't quite happen. And you get used to that as an architect, and it's really quite hard in the beginning because you put so much energy and love in, you know, it's a project. And this was an extraordinary project, but as I said, it did get away. This is Tilba in the south coast, very exposed, very beautiful. On the coast, sort of bizarre climate. Huge sort of possible house, but we sort of created them almost as jetties, creating harbours of sort of protection. And we were sort of working on ideas of both in model and computer, but mainly in models here of how we might prototype it, like not prototype it so much as modularise it and bring it to the site rather than building it all there because it's a very exposed, strong site. But that one didn't happen. And this one was sort of an interesting house, which is a house in Hunters Hill, which was for an interesting client who really just wanted to produce a lot of vegetables and almost like a farm around this house. So the house was quite just sort of elements within quite a strong garden. So all of this was sort of produce here and a bower across from this in this courtyard. It was quite interesting. This area here was basically could all open up so that her kitchen was almost like an outdoor kitchen. That was really exciting. They sort of broke up. So yeah, I don't know how people run a whole practice on houses. I don't know how to do it. However, I do love making houses for people, and I have a house. So these are some of this sort of runs to a completely different vibe. So I got involved. The cinemas were sort of my sort of introduction really to the QT hotel work. And these are fit out works. They're interesting works in that the client sort of loves design and wants everything designed. And this was the first job we did for him.
And this job is in the galleries and the State Building, the State Theatre Building in Sydney. You may know the State Theatre, that wonderful. So the client owns that and, you know, respects it greatly. In fact, I think they spent about 8 years fixing up the organ. It used to rise up. The film festivals always was in the State Theatre. So the building adjacent to that is the State Theatre Building. An extraordinary building, was the first vertical shopping centre, apparently, when it was first built, and the Gowans Building. This is the Gowans Building. So we worked in uniting the two buildings. Now, we weren't the master or mistress office, as they call it, but we did all the layouts, all the rooms, and then, of course, all the services coordination, and then we designed all the elements within actually the rooms and the hallways and the carpets. So this has sort of brought a completely different aspect of architecture to my practice and for me. So I've been designing carpets, and so it's quite extraordinary as a hotel, and they're beautiful buildings. This is the State Building, beautiful quality. I'll just keep moving this time. This is the latest Q2 we've been working on, which is in Melbourne. And these carpets, so I design carpets now. I mean, when the job requested. So this is a new building by Candelabras, and we've done, again, all the layouts for the bedrooms, all the lighting coordination, all the fit out and the apartments. So it's like 184 rooms and 15 apartments. I don't know how well you can see this. This is a sort of much more style that sort of is keener to my heart. Exposed concrete, a sort of elegant industrial sort of look, and all the pieces have been designed in my office, and then they're made in China, because to design every single item in a hotel room and have it made in Australia is impossible, so you don't get the design input. So then I go to China and work with the factories and make sure that we get the quality that we want. We worked with a Hong Kong based company here to make the bathrooms, so they're all panel systems that come ready-made, fabricated, and a set in place. They move, so there's sort of elements that are fixed, but they basically open up into, so you basically make one room out of the rooms. So that's opened up and then it can close back. Work closely with lighting designers to create sort of bespoke fittings to relate to that. So yeah, it's a 5-star hotel. Work with the artists to create unique pieces within the rooms. Work with graffiti artists to work up some rug ideas. So it was a local graffiti artist that we worked off his tag and worked up rugs. So it's a fun experience, and it takes about 3 years to do that. That's just sort of showing you some of the sort of hotels, just in terms of planning. So when the no smoking laws came in, didn't mean people stopped smoking, just meant that people wouldn't smoke right next to you if you were having a drink, so they'd move into courtyards and smoke. And that perhaps is, I don't know if that's even allowed now. So these were sort of different inner city buildings that we sort of made courtyards and just changed sort of the buildings to a degree. And they were quite an interesting period in our work. And it wasn't just fit out, you know, it's structural, because you're suddenly making a hole. You have to work out where you want to do that in a building, and that it has its integrity. And also, it's a noisy space suddenly, so there's a whole lot of other issues that come up, acoustic attenuation, and also just the making of a great space. So this is the last one we did. I haven't been doing probably a hotel for about 3 years, pubs. We won't do any more, done that. So then I started to work on big sort of commercial cinemas, which I never used to go to be honest. But I sort of found it quite an interesting challenge to work up a big public space in an artful way, not a crass way. You know, Greater Union was one of the most disgusting cinema brands I think I've ever sort of been in. So this was one we did in Miranda recently. Again, we worked with graphic artists. Certain things are the branding, so the colourings are not necessarily, you know, the blues are the VMAX branding, the reds are to do with the general cinemas, but you're basically given a big shell, whether it's a box or a sort of curved element or whatever it is, and you create cinemas in it, public spaces, the concourse. You know, the concourse is 60 metres long, so it can be an incredibly long space, or it can be actually quite interesting and innovative. Even though I've watched many a person walk straight along not looking at anything, and then go into the cinema, and I think, oh my God, they're really only coming for the movie. So, you know, but like this was sort of playing off the idea of the red velvet curtain in the old cinemas. So we worked with a graphic artist to create this incredible graphic. I mean, it's all digitalized, it's sort of blown up, and it's a vinyl, so you apply it as a wallpaper. And these are sort of playing off the idea of the old 3, 2, 5 newsreel. So they're the big numbers. The idea was these big coffers, and the coffers would be filled with light and light down, and then they work with, of course, the branding. Yeah. So the VMAX is actually, believe it or not, a graphic that I did work up with a graphic designer, so that became the brand for VMAX, and we use it in various ways in the jobs. The gold, like the lettering in that is not my own. The client gives me the graphics and in the terms of the fonts, and then we worked with those. So this is, you know, they're unique spaces, and every one we do is a bit different. So we're not sort of, it's almost like a nightclub, that one. This one was a big shed. It was just a big shed in Springfield in Queensland. And so we thought, oh, well, let's, it's called Events Cinemas, you know, it's the brand. So we thought, okay, well, it's like events under a big top. So that's what we did. So, you know, there's this thing called Scoop Alley. I mean, that's their brand. So we just try to make it, you know, as colourful and or as interesting as we can. It's this work, I can't change Scoop Alley in the sense of, I don't think we should have a Scoop Alley. Lollies are bad for kids. You know, that's not my role here. And so I could say, well, I'm not going to do cinemas. It's a Scoop Alley. Or I can just, you know, theatre will be theatre, cinemas will exist. And I'm just interested in seeing how we can make these spaces really sort of work in a new way and work with graphics. So because this was like a big shed, we had sort of construction, numbers into the cinemas and a graphic carrying down, and then the lights sort of a part of the VMAX lounge and bar. And the gold class we created here was all to do, again, it was a big void to do with ropes and rope lighting. And that's that stuff. And then this was another one we did about 4 years or 5 years ago. So they're all very different, and they're, I guess, determined by somehow the spaces we have, and also, you know, what we're trying to achieve and what, you know, it's working with the client, you know, to try and get as much timber as we could in this project. Not all projects I can sort of do that with. So it's just finding a way of creating a big public space that has a warmth and colour and energy about it. This one we did in Wellington, and it's a really beautiful little building. And so we played off the whole heritage, sort of the arches, and so this building exists. And then there was this long tunnel into a new section, which had two cinemas. And so we played off sort of an illusion to bring people down an archway, and then created a lounge for. And so this work came because I was making bars and doing that work in the inner city of Sydney, and the client wanted to bring bars into cinemas. So, you know, he found me. So that was, again, we did the part. So, with the work comes sort of very bespoke joinery. I thought I'd show you this to sort of maybe make you understand why a job might take 3 years. So this is really a family of joinery pieces. You know, we've thought about it, we've sort of related to it, we've decided on the palette. It was flat steel, it was leather, it was natural woods and natural veneers. So there were bed heads, two types of bed heads, wardrobes on a shelf, so it's a freestanding element. It doesn't have to be stuck into, you know, inscribed in and not quite fitting into an alcove. They're elements in their own right, and of beauty. Chairs. I have a wonderful guy, Johan, in my office who's got a real aptitude for working with chair design. So, you know, we work together to sort of get it right. So that's sort of how beauty that is. But these were two chair ideas that he developed for the two palettes. So I create two colour palettes, usually in a hotel, to keep the variation and the variety. And so the chairs evolved to the two palettes, basically. And the palettes are to do with colour. So in this hotel, it was turquoise and red, high contrast, and a very beautiful French blue, like deep Klein blue and gold. So, and that's why the carpet has those colours, because I've used the palette in the carpets to sort of indicate the rooms. So this is all work out of China, and it's really fine work, and it's been done through an Italian company. So the Italians understand, you know, they've got a great understanding about detail and design, and so I work with them, and then they work with their factories, and then I go to their factories once they're prototyped. So it's a good process. That's that part of it. These are the wardrobes that sit on the sort of timber shelf with the members. And those, we sort of worked up an idea of leather faced doors or upholstered doors within a very fine steel frame, and inside sort of beautiful wallpaper, just to surprise you, lit, backlit. And then the bed heads, an island bed and a wall bed, so I'll keep going. But you can see the level of detail is quite strong. And we've been doing this for years, I guess. You sort of forget what you've been doing. So we did that, you know, for Paddington Inn, so that they could, when we first did Paddington Inn, so that they could actually remove all that joinery, so it could be a big party in that back bar. And or not, and then, you know, so it comes out of fit out work. These were all movable furniture. Sorry, I'll keep going. So we do use computers and we do use 3D imagery, and we do take the client through that. And sometimes we also do make models, because I agree with Karen, you know, rooms really need to be made sometimes to really find something that's quite unique about it. But it's extraordinary how sort of real the modelling is. That's called with being constructed. That's one of those courtyards in Darlinghurst. I don't know if you know the Dalai Baths, but unusual. And it also helps us to separate out for the builder. So that was the concrete structure, then that was the concrete structure with the wall and the timber structure. It helps us, because, you know, it's really hard to sort of understand all the corners in a building, and of course there's obviously more that occurs later. So that's sort of the modelling. So that is the plan. Of course, you know, working with our builders and construction, and I actually don't really work on projects unless I can see it all the way through. You have to have that part of the process. It's like so critical and it's so fabulous. So yeah, that was cool being built. And then I'll just quickly go through. I mean, I'm not just throwing it out there, but of course ESD principles have to be fundamental. And, you know, yes, we may take it for granted, you know, you can't, and you have to think about it. And sort of every project that we work on, obviously we think about orientation and we think about, you know, ventilation and water storage, and different projects have demanded a different approach. And this is the mosque. So I didn't go all the way back about the mosque, and the mosque is a terrific story, which I'll tell you over dinner. But it didn't happen either. But we were second runner-up, and I did this with my Palestinian colleague, Omar Yusuf. And it was a very interesting project because there was a tomb. And above that, I don't know if anyone knows Nazareth, but there's a very remarkable concrete church to Mother Mary, I don't know what you call it, sorry. Very bold, very fabulous Italian concrete church, and it's at the entrance to Nazareth, and a very strong Christian community, of course, Nazareth, and feeling very threatened by the growing Muslim community. But, you know, they've all sort of been part of that greater community. And below it was this tomb, and the Islamic community, were pressuring to create a grand mosque with seven minarets, and, you know, below this, which was really, you know, concerning the Christians. However, our approach was to actually wrap the tomb and create one minaret and create a building based on traditional environmental detailing, because there's so much fabulous detailing from the people of the desert. You know, the privacy screens, but they were also water for the women, but they were also water screens. Waters flowed down and cross-ventilated, cooled the inner room. So we had the mashrabiya here, and this acted as a heat vent to let out the hot air. And so we worked very, very strongly with this. And it did sort of end up looking like a more secular building than a sort of traditional mosque. Even though, you know, the Sufi idea of the spiral and the dance is actually very spiritual and sort of based in Islamic teachings. It was a very interesting thing, and basically we came second, but the Jordanian architect who won, he sort of created a mosque with like accretion, as if, you know, he had an old minaret and an old this and an old that, and we sort of thought, why are you doing, you know, why are you doing that? How come it's why? And before we knew it, through, you know, news and that, they'd started building, and I really think they hoped that they'd get it up. And no one would, you know, I mean, of course people would notice, but it just would look like it had always been there. Whereas our building was like weird and unusual. And anyway, the whole project was stopped, not just us, but the actual building was stopped because it became a very huge political, because it's Israel. I think I've probably done. Show you some of those hotel jobs had quite, you know, strong structural backbone because we were, you know, we were creating long, large spaces and we had to support buildings above. And you know, I love structure. So even though I might be a fit-out queen, I really like structure and I love being an architect. So these pub jobs were quite, you know, they were great because they did allow all of that to happen, plus concrete ring beams. We use a lot of lighting, and I don't know if you sort of get involved with lighting, but I do love lighting, and I like integrating it, you know, into the work. And of course, these sort of spaces demand it. That was an amazing. That was my very first job for the client, which was really interesting because it was the moment when film was sort of ending and digital projection was happening. And so that was my first and last experience of going into the bio boxes and seeing the rolls of film going from one cinema room to the other, you know, hung off the ceiling. And so we had, this was an old cinema and it was became a standalone bulk class. And we had this big bulkhead. We thought, oh no, you know, because there was a bio box up here. Bio box is where you the projection room. And we thought, oh, what are we going to do? And then we decided, of course, we'll fill it with film, because that was it. That's all filled with Bollywood film that was in these wonderful straw baskets, if you can believe it, film. And we backlit it, and it became this beautiful thing. So anyway, that's that. And light, of course, which is really important. So these are just, you know, Exchange, that's sort of Sutherland Street. That's a building that we did in Balmain and Roselle, which Dan Palin Wall, you know, it's that sort of Cadillac plastic honeycomb. It was developed in Israel for the glass houses, but it's plastic. You'd know it because a lot of people have made walls in that. But it's quite a beautiful, though you have to fire it. It's a commercial building. And then I think this might be the last, sorry, I'm probably getting a bit itchy. The work that I do in the hotels allows me, because I push it, to integrate art into the projects, and I try to push that as much as I can. So I push lighting design. You know, I don't work with electrical engineers to create lighting designs. Like, I work with designers, and I work off my understanding and passion for that. And so I have very tiny budgets, but I've managed to work with different, you know, wonderful artists. And we have to repeat things. So we might have three different art objects, or five different art objects for 185 rooms. But at least it's up there, and it adds to the whole sort of feeling. I've worked with glass artists, making light fittings, glass blown fittings, in some of these gold glass cinemas. I work with Juice Design quite a bit. You might know them. They're great graphic designers. So this was another project at North Lakes out of Brisbane, where we again created a graphic which had meaning to the whole thing, but creating depth into these long, you know, concourse walls. That's the VMAX branding wall. Wow. And yes, in Paddington in early days, you know, it's gone now. I mean, that's the nature of this sort of work, you know, it's gone. It doesn't exist anymore. 10 years later, it's completely different. But we worked with this wonderful woman, Sam Goetz, who was a textile designer. She'd never done anything like this before. And we worked off patterns and things, and these were all acoustic panels. And so these were all perforated aluminium panels that we then printed on. And this is a very early work that I worked with a designer, and then the graphic designer did all the branding signs, and that's a Terrell window. So that was done, that's probably many decades ago. So yeah, I've always been into that. I never realised I was till suddenly these opportunities came up. But I've always sort of loved art and painted and drawn. So I guess this is giving me, you know, the opportunity. And the client, though, he keeps every now and then saying, you know, you could repeat yourself. You know, we could have the same. I go, well, you know, my team wouldn't really be interested, and I wouldn't be that interested. But so this was need a lot of acoustic understanding in these jobs. And this was our latest work in North Lakes, the gold class, where we explored the use of, because we had just big spaces. We decided maybe, you know, we don't need to sheet them with gyprock, let's just expose them, paint them black, all the surfaces, and then drop interesting ceilings below. And then, of course, you need acoustics so that the whole place doesn't echo. And so that's that echo panel. It was a bit of a challenge to get those things for the builder, to get those straight. Paddington Inn, before it became something else, acoustics in a lot of places. So, you know, I don't think acoustic kills the vibe in a place, although a lot of people think that. You know, they want it noisy. It's still noisy, but at least, you know, these are all felt panels that absorb. There's acoustics above that, and then this sort of mesh ceiling just allows something else to happen. That whole courtyard is acoustic inside. These were all acoustic panels. So, yeah, I think that's it. It's enough. That was all acoustic as well, with the baffles. So this is because these were inner city parks. You had people living, you know, next door. And I'm not going to make a space that, you know, everybody's hating and you're ringing up the RSL like I do next door.
The RSL that I live next to, who doesn't give about acoustics at all. They won't spend a dollar.
Well, these clients were concerned because obviously it's not a good thing for their business. And also we want to make spaces that work well for everybody, not just for those inside. So, yeah, I think I must have come to the end.